Our speaker tonight is Professor Moussa Samb from Dakar, who will give a talk about the topic Mediation as Efficient Source of Traditional Dispute Resolution in Africa. Before I will give the floor to him, it is my pleasure to introduce Professor Samb. Moussa Samb is Professor of Private Law and Business Law at the University Cheikh Anta Diop in Dakar. I do hope that I pronounced this correctly, in Senegal. Having obtained his bachelor and licence in law at the University of Cheikh Anta Diop, he went on to get a Master of Comparative Law at the University Paris 1, Panthéon-Sorbonne. Subsequently, he obtained a degree as Doctor of Private Law at the University Cheikh Anta Diop. His interest in comparative law also led him to the United States, where he deepened his knowledge in the U.S. law and legal institutions at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. Professor Moussa Samb has worked in a wide range of fields and has held a variety of positions. Among others, he was director of studies at the Peace and Human Rights Center at the University of Dakar. For a number of years, he served as senior program officer in the program Governance, Equity, and Health of the International Development Research Center in Canada. He has also held the position as Director of Research and Documentation of OHADA, the Organization for the Harmonization of Business Law in Benin. As Director of Research at the Faculty of Law of the University Cheikh Anta Diop, his tasks included designing and drafting model laws and regulations, as well as designing training programs for parliamentarians, judges, and policymakers. As a professor at the University Cheikh Anta Diop, he teaches economic law as well as comparative law, and he also regularly offers a master's course on contract law in Africa within the program Master of Business Law and Cross-Cultural Practice at the University of Fribourg in Switzerland. Professor Samb has been a visiting professor and fellow to a number of renowned universities and institutions so far. Among others, he was a visiting scholar and senior Fulbright scholar at Georgetown University Law Center, my own alma mater as well, in Washington, D.C., invited professor at the University of Paul Cézanne, ex-Marseille, Troyes, as well as most recently, a fellow at the Institut d'études avancées in Nantes. And now, as we are very happy, he is a fellow, I'm very happy to say he's a fellow here at our center since October. Professor Samb has published extensively on a broad range of subjects, including promotion and protection of African human rights, the privatization of public services in sub-Saharan Africa, the right to water, credit protection, as well as justice and governance in Senegal. Notably, he is also co-author of the Encyclopédie du droit OHADA. Soon, we are expecting a monograph on mediation as an alternative method of dispute resolution for social conflicts in Africa, which is also the subject of his research here at our center. And this brings us to our topic tonight, mediation as an efficient source of traditional dispute resolution in Africa. And we are very much looking forward to your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Director Nina Deplof, for this introduction. And as you mentioned, you say mediation as efficient. I think that probably we'll come back on that. Professor Gepard told the validate traditional dispute. You say efficient, I wrote effective. You see the exact word to put, but I think effective is probably more correct, and I come in my English, which is not a professional one, than effective, but it's two different meanings. But first, let me thank you very much, Professor, and also thank Professor Gepard, who I met in Nantes last year, Institut des Etudes Avancées, where he was in the team to supervise the work of the Institute. And then I met him there, and I'm very pleased to join you in the center, and I was very, very interested by the adventure you launched to search the meaning of law and its interaction with culture. I hope that the broad subject and also the all the meaning of the program, I will add something coming with the my little knowledge of Africa. But I hope also that my stay here will build relationship with African institutions, and especially with Chahante Diop University, which is one of the oldest universities in Africa. I will have a lot of program in the law school at the Faculté de Lettres, and I think that we'll definitely have to exchange between our center, your center, and our university, and probably, hopefully, probably to organize someday something in Dakar. So my topic, as I mentioned, is exactly a mediation as validated, efficient, or effective traditional dispute resolution in Africa. I, on the request of Professor Detloff, sent two papers. I don't know if you have the time to read it. Those two papers illustrate the controversy on the topic, and especially the discussion or the reply of David Heiser, who did the work on Gambia, on mediation, replying to the a paper published by Professor Laura Neder, who put a very critical point on the underside of conflict management in Africa and elsewhere. I will probably come back on this controversy, but just at this time, I want to note and quote David Heiser, who probably in his introduction give me the word to situate the problematic for which I will talk. I quote him, he say, human social dynamics are amazingly complex, and the most holistic scholarly perspective are usually situated somewhere between opposing theoretical poles. It is in this case that mediation may act as a medium for the activity proposed by both its critic and its proponent. And he was true because he was replying to, as I said, Laura Neder paper, but also you'll see that my research will address some issues. I don't have a reply now, but I will at the end probably stress some question issues that will be in the front of my research activities. But before to come that, I would just situate the problem. We're talking about Africa, but Africa is too big. Most of the research I will mention for is situated in West Africa, and with some glance to a few countries outside this zone, but my research will be situated mostly in West Africa. This picture and the sound accompanying the picture show the Nyamankala. Nyamankala is a group of mediators. And this is very ancient, because Nyamankala signify only those who have the power. And they used to definitely, before any mediation seance, have this kind of activity in order to make people happy, you know. And then they will listen to the people. I will come back on this point. And this picture is a very distant one, but exactly, it's in Mali, the group of Nyamankala. I will come back on this issue. On my presentation, I will definitely come back on the concept issues, which have been very important also in the discussion between Nora Nader and David Heiser. And mostly the concept issue in the center of my presentation will be certainly traditional and mediation. Then I will present the main actors on mediation. Before coming to the process itself, which I will divide in 2 points, the tradition and the mechanism. And then I will end by addressing or presenting my research issues and the topic I want to address during my stay in the center and after the center. On the conceptual level, I see the two concepts you see are very controversial and critical. The one is the tradition and the second one is mediation. With regard to tradition, traditional legal anthropological research focuses on differentiation between custom and law. For the most part, the absence of written court or statute in indigenous Africa, pre-colonial but also colonial period, Africa was the major part defined and characteristic of custom as an immemorial traditional social order, largely immutable and closely linked to the cultural system. But if we look for a definition of tradition, I would mention the one proposed by Weber, 1977, quote again, tradition refers to behavior, institution, and practice that derive from the past. But the very process of invention makes tradition all subject to change as custom. Then I will also quote a friend of Professor Gepard, Mamadou Diouf, my friend Mamadou Diouf, who teaches actually at Columbia University. And in one of his papers, he defined tradition and make the difference between tradition and custom. I quote him, tradition are different to custom that are the product of the colonial interpretation and reformulation of African culture for political and administrative purpose. They were co-produced by African society and colonial administration. So the point is to make the differentiation between tradition and custom. And the fact that by tradition, we don't mean something which is forgiven or something which is very old, something which is archaic, okay? But because traditional internal process may need adjustment to the past rule, to the present challenges. So there is a feedback where the traditional practices need to be adapted to contemporary situation. Instead of repeating the colors on the languages of the past, which might be probably something we can call customs. But in all the case, those operations of adaptation, of readaptation, are validated by the society. Traditional African legal anthropology research makes a differentiation between custom and law. Also, for the most part, the absence of written court or statute in pre-colonial Africa was a major defining characteristic of custom as an immemorial traditional order, largely immutable and closely linked to the cultural system. It is difficult to deny that even today, most of the people of the continent of Africa remain attached to the traditional ways of life. And this is true not only of the predominant rural population, but also for urban dwellers and the elite, the political elite, as well to retain their rural and primordial ties and loyalties through the various ethnic and cultural associations that proliferate in the urban civil society. Then, we can say that the notion of tradition itself remains very open. Conflict management practices also are considered traditional if they have been practiced for an extended period of and have evolved from within African society rather than being the product of external importation. So I come to say that tradition continues to exist even in the contemporary or modern period, and they are even practiced today. Most of the tradition we are referring to are practiced today. Certainly, there is a little update and there is new creation, but this tradition continues to exist. And the first characteristic of traditional system of dispute resolution now is that, like other strands of prevalent national heritage, conflict management is experiential and undocumented. But the system have been preserved and propagated through folklore, songs, other cultural talks, sculpture, painting, and other forms of art. Another characteristic is also the mix of diffusion of conflict management is the religious, social, cultural, and political practice. But mostly, we see that conflict management practices are enclosed in cultural and other religious observance. Also, this is not specific to Africa. It may be found in other primitive society, as shown by Walter Bogle in 2006, he studied the Bougainville, which is a native of Papua New Guinea. He described, I quote him, "When solutions have been achieved, they are sealed in highly ritual forms. Ceremonies are of great symbolic and practical importance. They are a means of conflict transformation in their own right. The whole community participates in them. They are loaded with spiritual meaning, wealth exchanges, prayers, and sacrificing to the God, to the gods, to the spirit of the ancestors are part of this ceremony, as well as customary rituals such as breaking spears and arrows, drinking and eating together, singing and dancing together, or consuming certain drugs." He was talking of the Papua New Guinea, the Bougainville, but almost it is a separate, practically the same for each of the ethnic in Africa. We can also say that mediators usually derive their authority from traditional role and function, from the age, because mostly they are elderly people, from their status as in the society. We'll see that women play a very important role as mediators. The role of secret society have also to be mentioned, with the mythical and ritual powers which are exercised through mask and masquerade and all the folklore around the mediation. Let me come now on the concept of mediation itself. By mediation, we mean the procedure by which a third party helps the other party in a conflict to reach an acceptable peaceful settlement through principle of negotiation or problem solving or transformation of the structural condition that underlie the dispute. The definition is practically classical, and it's the same everywhere, even for the very popular now mediate.com, which is an online dispute resolution platform. You know how the alternative dispute revolution have seen a revival, especially in the United States, in America, but also in Europe. At the time where, you know, there is something like lack of confidence on the justice, on the modern justice system. This is not only in Africa, with the corrupt justice system and everywhere, and especially in the United States also, it is the case. So mediation.com is an online dispute resolution platform which is used to exchange discussion, but also which may be used to mediate some conflict. And in all the case, there is a need to differentiate and make the distinction clear between mediation and the other procedures, which are arbitration and adjudication. The very fact to make the differentiation is the fact that mediation don't come up out with binding solution because it derived to consensus, while arbitration and adjudication come with binding solution. But we'll see also that they were practiced in traditional Africa. And in traditional Africa, the difference is made very clearly between mediation and adjudication or arbitration. But many of the practice of conflict resolution are classical mediation, meaning that there is a third-party catalyst. We have, in the case of Africa, a strong spirit, cultural spirit, and we come between the parties to seek an agreement. Before an agreement, to reach a common definition of the problem and to find a solution that might be defined in terms of trade between the parties and serve as basis of some agreement between the parties. The mediator has essentially to work on the offended desire in order to come to a reintegration, but at the same time to obtain the desire of the society to stay in harmony, in order, and in justice. And outside of giving to one or another party the thought, he has also as an outcome to bring to the party together and to restore the harmony in the society. In the condition of legal pluralism, disputants have make their disputant choice partly as a result of the relationship between the litigant, where the law has a penal, compensatory, therapeutic, or conciliatory style. It depends on the rank between the disputant and their degree of intimacy or relationship. But also the future of the disputant relationship is very important in selecting a particular disputing process. Well, that's why mediation seems very relevant in particularly in family issues, in land tenure issues, and less probably in penal issues. I'm coming back now to present a few traditional mechanisms of conflict prevention, which came to more understand how mediation is practiced, because those are cultural practices very important to understand if we need to place the mediation in context. And this practice, which have been called the medicine of conflict, I choose two of them, which is sacrificial alliance and joking kinship. Let me come to on sacrificial alliance. One of the basic principles of pre-colonial Africa was the intervening between the spiritual and the temporal, and the prevalence of some magic beliefs and practices in everyday life in the society. Then, the story reveals that the singular aspect of prevention of intercommunity conflict by the sacrificial blood pact or alliance. Few examples to show that. The first one is the pact known in central Cameroon as Manjara. Manjara was a pact concluded between different ethnic groups, the Voute, the Mboum, the Tikar, the Bamun, and all these ethnic groups share this pact, which is the Manjara. And to seal the pact, they kill a Voute, an animal, and they mix the blood of the animal with their same blood, their own blood, and they went to the ritual practice, sacrifice, who make the two communities who were supposed to fight, were supposed to oppose in violence, to seal a pact of no transgression. And then the Manjara helped to reduce the conflict between the communities. In fact, it's a factor of peace between the individuals and the communities. we find the same kind of alliance within the group we call the Bamileke. Bamileke are very well known in Cameroon, in Western Cameroon, because they are very active in trade, and not in the political sense, but very active in trade. And everybody knows the Bamileke in Cameroon, because when you go to the market, when you go in the economy, this is the group really who have the economy. But at the same time, the Bamileke are also very marked by tradition. And it is one of the most densely populated regions in Africa. So we can understand that land conflict issues are very frequent in the region of Western Cameroon. The territory is divided into a multitude of chiefdoms, whose history was marked by the expansion and the constitution of a living place. A memorable example is the alliance between Chiefdom Baham and Banjum. A solemn peace was proclaimed and symbolized by two sacred trees planted on both sides of the border. And over the years, the branch of the trees intermingled, hitting the imagination of the people, who saw that as a phenomenon of superstition, a sign of permanent union. In West Africa, we can say that many people, many ethnic groups have forged sacrificial alliance. That's why in a remarkable study on Annie Dende of Côte d'Ivoire, Claude Helen Perrault reviews some ritual performed by the alliance. Thus, the Abred and the Akie group have taken fetish. The fetish was Anwa, whereby they become brother and sister. And it was through a religious ceremony that the alliance was concluded. Generally, a beverage specially prepared was solemnly consumed by participants, and each contracted party invoked the protector of this community by worship, offered libation and sacrifice. And the alliance was concluded and assured the safety of both groups, dissuade any aggressive inclination, and singularly favor the free movement of people and goods within the country. Another similar alliance is also the one between the Sentongo and the Barkoli in Uganda. And then also there is a Mukago, which is a blood pact in Uganda, where individuals from different families or kinship groups create a family bond between them, irrespective of their religion or their status, their social status. The pact only symbolizes a binding lifetime assurance of mutual support, commitment to non-aggression and openness, all based on love and trust between the parties. But to enter in the pact, party brings a coffee sherry, and each one takes beans and puts some of their blood on it from a small cut on their navels. Then each party eats the bean with the blood of the other person on it to seal the pact. And the pact, as a matter of fact, is considered semi-divine, unbreakable, and it is not recorded in written form, but it is unbreakable for each of the parties. But no written document could record this procedure because it's something which is kind of supernatural, and because of the fact also that the party believe on the punishment, the imminent punishment for any aggression or denaturation of the pact. After the sacrificial alliance, which we may find in most of the part of Africa, let me come now on another traditional mechanism which is very important, and we may find it practically everywhere in West Africa, is what we call the joking kinship of pleasantry. What social scientists are discussed in numerous papers, but with different names. Some we call it joking kinship, some way joking relationship, and special affinities, in French, cousinage, plaisanterie, etc., etc. But joking kinship derives from customary ties that link various groups and individuals. Many Africans and the majority of ethnic groups are connected by overlapping networks of this relationship, which can include reciprocal obligation, behavioral taboos, and stereotyping by ethnicity, religion of origin, and clan affiliation. Joking kinship have been proposed as grassroots institutions that reinforce positive inter-eating interaction and mitigate intergroup conflict. The joking relationship include mutual obligation, manifested also in semi-ritualized manner. The joke usually revolve around food, with individuals who share chastised teasing each other about their big bellies, their exceptional love of eating, etc. And this relationship involves greater freedom of speech and behavior, as one is allowed to interact with joking partner in a manner that would ordinarily be frowned upon a cause offense. For instance, joking relationship partners have the right to insult each other. They have the right to insult, and then party have challenged to not become angry of each other. And harming a joking partner is strongly prohibited by the larger society. Joking relationship may also exist between members of the ethnic group, or between one ethnic group and another ethnic group. For example, the Fulbe in West Africa have what we call dendiraku. Dendiraku is a mutual assistant which can connote a taboo against any mutual treachery. I think I put an exchange between the Fulbe just to show the... This is, for example, the joking example of the joking relationship between the Bambara and the Pearls in West Africa. Bambara and the Pearls used to have this joking relation, and each of them have a poem to describe the other group. In this, you have the way that the Bambara think about the Pearls. Pearls are usually pastoral peoples, right? While Bambara are rural and peasant, agriculture, not very well known on working, but very influential in terms of politics. And they say, what the Bambara say in the Pearl, is the white river in the middle east of black waters, black river in the middle of white waters, enigmatic black people, because generally the Pearls are little white men, they are not very black, yeah? Okay? And somebody say they come from Egypt, you know. Enigmatic black people, or capricious vermine from the east, have dumped upon the black country like ants that destroy ripe fruits, who move in without permission, and move out without saying goodbye, a brewery of noisy acrobats, always coming and going to find new water holes and meadows. And this is the way they describe the Pearls, and the Pearl give the reply. And what this is what the Pearl think about the Bambara. What is the Bambara? A man that got carved hastily in a trunk of ordinary wood. With just a few blows of his hatch, here is a Bambara man who comes out of the workshop with a head as flat as teapot over Astor's basket. A nose masked like a trodden sandwich, condemned to carry bundles of wood on his head. The spirit of the pure-blooded Bambara is more to be found in his face rather than in his brain. This is the way also that the Pearl described the Bambara. Then, when joking, this type of joking relationship is practiced between the Fulbe and also the same joking are practiced between the Fulbe and the other group in West Africa. We find, for example, in Nigeria, the joking relationship exists between the Fulbe and the Tiv in northern Nigeria. And also, it was a practice developed as a result of land overuse between the two communities. And after agreeing to negotiate, they established a joking relationship so to avoid the future generation to enter in conflict. Let me now come back on actor of mediation, and then I would separate three actors which are very important. I announced the fact that women play a very important role in mediation, what we call the diplomatic agents, and then the classical mediators. Coming back to women, we can notice that in many communities, a special place was given, for example, to paternal aunts in matter of crisis management and conflict resolution. For example, among the Bakosi in Cameroon, paternal aunts were responsible of reconciling individuals which are involved in conflict. This practice exists in other countries. The other categories of women play the same role in society. For example, the Ndjukui in Cameroon were women, and women who took part as mediators on discussion aimed at resolving conflict. It was also in these communities that one found the very influential and fierce secret society, which is called the Juru, whose members were exclusively women. And the role of the Juru, this association, this group of women, was to maintain peace in the community. One of the characteristics of the Juru mask, for example, was that it sometimes becomes very dangerous and very aggressive. As a result, when its power was unleashed, only a pregnant or recently delivered woman could calm it. This was because children represent another potent symbol of peace in African society. The pregnant woman symbolized also peace among the community. She was naturally she was therefore a natural mediator. Even a criminal who found refuge in a house of a pregnant woman was not pursued, but left in peace as long as he remained in such a sacred place of refuge. The mazake also are old women who play a very important role on keeping watch over the community. They were on the alert and reacted immediately at the first sign of destructive conflict between the members of the community. If, for example, they notice sign of conflict or institute quarrel, they promptly summon the protagonists in order to question and calm them. They listen to them, and after they find a solution. And when the mediator were satisfied, then they again summon the protagonists and ask them to drink, have a drink together, and to seal a reconciliation. You may find the same kind of practice with the Beti. Going further. This is another example. They call them Mambi, which is also same rituals driven by the woman. Then I come to the diplomatic agents. Traditional African society have never lived in isolation. They usually facilitate the movement of peoples and goods. And even in linear society, thus give the birth to a group of traders. And they use also to have association between different communities. We can see that in different African kingdom and empire. And then was a special category called the diplomats, which are the ambassadors settled between different places, and they used to travel and to go between and find a solution to potential conflict. For example, in the 16th century, there is one Idrissa Aloma, which is the emperor of Bonn, but we can go further. In 1466 was the Charter of Kouragan Fouga in Mali, which had been set up after a war between the community. And this charter, the Charter of Kouragan Fouga, is one of the ancient documents, we can say, of human rights in the world. Then the African people have given very much importance to negotiation procedures and by using the diplomatic agents, using interpersonal relations between the leader by exchange of gift and wives, and sometimes as a sign of demarcation and opposition to aggression. The negotiations often are conducted in secret under the leadership of the diplomats who act as a representative of their groups. For example, in the Bamileke in Western Cameroon, we have the Wala and Nifo. Wala and Nifo are the notable of the court, whose task is essentially to act as a plenipotentiary communication agents. And then they have the qualities necessary skills to make this job. But the Bamun was really approved group of conciliation, and also they have a title of Tet Kune, who is a permanent organ of negotiation. Those diplomatic agents have to be differentiated to mediators, okay? Because the mediators, as I define, is a third party whose job is to facilitate a communication, whose job is to serve as a bridge between the parties, and also to use his power to get a solution. The instrumental role of mediation was demonstrated in the past by many oral traditions. We have to collect some of them. Some of them are already translated by numerous papers. But these mediators in traditional Africa require special qualities on age, wisdom, knowledge, and customs, and the history of group, knowledge of the story of the group living in the territory. But in any case, the mediator must above all be neutral and objective. He must have no alliance, especially matrimonial, with the group on conflict. He must have full confidence of the protagonist, who then brought their motivation on discussion. He should have to be also a communicator, as we seen with the Nyamankara. The mediator have to be very eloquent. You have to be a master of words, because when the ceremony starts, you have to calm the people and have to situate the conflict in a manner that, using proverbs and sayings, he already put the parties able to discuss and able to come on agreement. So then, extreme case of mutual hostility arrive where it's not possible to reach a result. But mediation was very successful in many of the cases. For example, I mentioned the Nyamankara, very, very powerful in Mali, because the parties believe that the Nyamankara have a powerful, they control the Nyama with the power. And then this spiritual belief is very important, giving them the authority to mediate between the parties. Even today, you see in some society, in some countries, an adaptation of the traditional institution of mediation in contemporary world. For example, I will just rapidly mention the Abunzi community in Rwanda. But Abunzi community in Rwanda are very different to the one of the institutions of Rwanda, which is Gacaca. Gacaca played a very important role after genocide. But there is differentiation to make between Gacaca, who is probably more specialized in penal issues and criminal case, and the Abunji, which is mostly a mediation community, preserved by the law, and the law recognizes the possibility to recourse to the Abunji rather than going before the court. We see the same things in equally in Sudan, for example, in Darfur, which is very known as having a very violent community conflict. There is an institution called Judia, which is a grassroots institution of mediation, and one focus on interacting between peoples to settle a conflict, but which have not been very active in the conflict, in the current conflict in Darfur, but we can take it in consideration in order to find a durable solution. I'm coming now on the fact that, firstly, because time is coming going, that there is different mechanisms on mediation. The time is also too short to show all them, but I will mention only what we call the palabra. The palabra. A palabra is also something very important in traditional Africa. It was a very fundamental element, even if there is some nuance between different countries. But it was an institution. an institution who is a place of debating issues on the society, and also the issues of conflict in the society. For example, debaters have to organize usually the palaver. And the palaver was a time where young children, talkative people, have occasion to say their own belief on one or a conflict with placed on the public. And during the palaver, the peacemakers used to introduce the conflicted party, and then at the same time, with participation of magicians, sorcerers, the assembly is informed of a conflict, and a solution is found in public. And the fact is that it is necessary to avoid conflict in all costs, and to make the party in conflict conscious that this is not only an individual thing, because all the society might be disturbed by the conflict. In Bamileke country, the place where the palaver is organized is called Tree of Peace. Then we don't have time, but also I'm actually collecting different cases on mediation, especially on family and on land issues, which I we try to discuss, and in order to have solve few research issues, I think very important to address the question, not only to just repeat what is good in the tradition, but also this is very important to note, and I think that the papers I distributed to you, especially the papers of Laura and others, specify the very need to avoid to be have a nostalgia of the tradition. And I think it points to a very important question when I quote her, when she said, "We need epistemological models that allow us to understand the interaction of law, power and tradition, and what are the links with political and economic issues." I think that it will be my direction. We will need in this research to not fall on the low nostalgia, but to probably understand more the interaction between law, power and tradition. For example, try to define how are such resources of mediation formed, which social actors are contributing to their formation, which one of the parties are excluded and why. And then we probably try to go deep in circumstances where the logic of inequality and domination may triumph on the logic of mediation. I will also probably try to see, studying the cases, how the mediators were selected, was an institution, or was it specially affected to a special social category? I mentioned the Yamankula in Mali, but I don't know if it is the case in all the countries. What is the framework within which the discussion is possible? Especially a question to know exactly if there was an exit option to mediation, or when a conflict arise, if there is a possibility to go not to mediation but for arbitration or adjudication, and then find different case story, we will show and illustrate the reply to all discussion. I'm stopping here, and because I take a lot of time, and I really appreciate your listening, and I'm ready to reply to all the questions. Thank you.